application. But I just want to make sure the packet understands what we're decoding there. And then I'm going to bring the two real value controls open and up and the value output of each of these two floats to a real. So that's assume real bound. Now back on the form, so if we take a look at the generic real value 1, we can see that it has an event on process data. So I'm going to go ahead and put a handler into this event. So the edit on the test is equal to floats struct, and we'll use the out value parameter to being passed in. So that's going to give us our access value. I'm then going to repeat this process for generic real 2, but in this case I'm going to repeat this into edit 2. So let's go ahead and run this application. And it's not working. Okay, what did I miss? The comp call is connected to, so this is on comp 3 for my device. Okay, let's run that. And we have data showing, so as I move the controller around, we can see that these two data points are changing. So we have some data coming in from our device. Let's see how we build a thin point to push that data up into our EMS server. Okay, so to build the thin point, I'm going to start a new multi-device application. Now, you don't have to start a multi-device application. You could use a VCL application, or if you want to create components at runtime, you could use a command line or even a Windows Service application. But it's just convenient for me to go and grab and drop these components so that you can see them. So I'm going to start with a visual right now. And I'm going to go ahead and save this all up right away, and I'm going to put it in a directory named EMS thin point. So you can go ahead and download the subversion source and find this project as EMS thin point. Okay, so we need two components for our thin point. We need an EMS producer, a provider, and the provider is effectively the client component for our EMS server. So this is what's going to connect up to the EMS server, do handshaking, register services, and so on. And we then want an edge service provider, or an EMS edge service, and this is going to effectively be the server side part of the thin point. So on my machine, it's called the host. So on your setup, you may have your thin point somewhere else on the network. You need to put the IP address of the EMS server in here. And then for the port, well, the EMS server I'm using is the developer edition. It's on port 8080 and it's HTTP protocol. Then for the edge service, I need to make sure that the provider is bound, because the edge service is going to advertise itself as being available through this provider. One proxy which we can't change but is published and looks like it needs to be set is the listener service. And this is published for various runtime typing reasons, but we can't actually set this, but we're going to make use of this in code. We also need to set our module name, so I'm going to call this EMS endpoint. And that's what we're going to register our edge service as. Okay, so now we set these proxies up, let's see what we can do with these components. The first thing I'm going to do is use the EMS provider to make sure I can do a handshake with my EMS server. So I'm going to go ahead and drop a button on my form here, and I'm going to set the text proxy to handshake. What this means is that I should be able to do a test call for the service to make sure that it's there. The way I'm going to do that is I'm going to call EMS provider app handshake, and then I'm going to put in an anonymous method, and the prototype is procedure. JSON object. So effectively the app handshake button returns, we'll call our anonymous method and pass it as a JSON object. And all we want to do with that object is show a message and let's take the JSON format this object as a pretty string for me. And we'll pass in a dodge. Okay, now in order to use that, I'm going to need to put in system.json, and I'm also going to need the list.json in this unit. Okay, let's go ahead and run that application. And there are errors. What did I get wrong? System.json is redefined. Okay, that's already in there, so I don't need to have it. Okay, so we have EMS server running in the background. Let's go ahead and pull that up for you. I'm going to go ahead and hit handshake, and you can see that I've got the version of the EMS data come back. Okay, good. So that means that our ThinkPoint is able to see the EMS server across the network. So the next thing we want to do is register this ThinkPoint so that the EMS server knows about it. So first things first, I'm going to look in my EMS management console and make sure they're connected, do a refresh of the modules, and there is nothing registered. We need to get our ThinkPoint registered in here. Okay, the way we do that is I'm going to put a new button on my form, and I'm going to set the text to register. And then I'm going to set myself a little plug-in here and copy-paste some code here. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to use the EMS edge service and set its listening protocol. Now, in terms of listening protocol for HTTP, you remember that property that I said we couldn't set? Well, that's because the property has been created for us. It's this EMS edge service 1 listener service. And this listener service is basically a pluggable protocol handler. And so I'm going to cast it as a custom EMS edge HTTP listener. That's because I'm using the HTTP protocol. And I'm going to set the host address to localhost. Now that actually, on this occasion, this is not the host address of the EMS server. This is the host address of the input. So again, if your input is up on the network somewhere, put a suitable IP address or host name in there so that the EMS server knows where to go look when it's looking for the input. And the same thing is true with the port number. I'm using 8082 because my EMS server is on the same machine as my input, and it's already using port 8080 and 8081, so I just go to the next available. And then we're going to go ahead and call register module. So that's going to register this module with the EMS console. Let's go ahead and give that a test. And I've got some errors because I need a user support text, which is this EMS hosted HTTP list. Okay. So I'll go ahead and bring my EMS console back. I'm going to test my handshake again, we're all good. I hit register. And if I do a refresh over here, I get EMS endpoint and it's showing me that it's registered. Most importantly, this EMS server now knows localhost 882 is where my pinpoint is at. Now, if you want some feedback when your EMS edge service is registered, we have the events on registered and we also have on unregistered, so you can go put messages or log messages or have you get there. I need to do that, I just registered my module, so the third thing we need to do with our endpoints is add a resource to it. Now, first thing we're going to do is add in a special unit here, which I'm going to come back to, and this is EMS resource types. And I'm going to come back and show you why this is added in. In fact, I'm going to close it out so that I can show you what the problem is if you don't remember to include that. So, we've got that there, but we're going to come back in a moment. What I need to do now is build up a class which represents the resource that I'm going to be publishing. Again, I'm going to copy and paste this because I don't really feel like typing it, and this is my text. So I'm going to pass in a key resource, and it is publishing a get method. And this get method should look relatively familiar. Ignoring the context proxy for the moment, we have a request and a response. So as you saw when we built an endpoint earlier, it's a request response system. This is how REST works. So what we need to do is look at the request, decide what the EMS server is asking us to do, and provide the appropriate response when we build a handle for this method. Now these parameters are going to be passed in by the endpoint edgeware code, so we don't need to worry about passing them in, we just need to handle them. You also notice that I have method info on, method info off. Effectively, I want to make sure that there is runtime type information for the key my resource class, because if it was published this, the EMS software is going to go on and put the type information. And I don't want this resource to be registered as the key my resource. I would give it a more friendly name. So I put this attribute, resource name, and call it joystick. And I think that this is going to return the data from our admin joystick eventually. So currently I'm using +n, it's just another directive to ensure the runtime type information is produced as needed. Now with this class, I need to implement the get method. So let's go ahead and put an implementation in here. Again, just take some typing. I'm going to go ahead and do some copy pasting here. And let's look at what we have. So help result data, I'm just creating a result type of JSON object. So I'm going to create an instance of that object, and I'm going to add two pairs, so two proxies to the object, x-axis and y-axis. Again, we're going to be getting data from our joystick component, so I'm going to pass them out the x-axis and the y-axis balance. And then I'm just passing in some dummy values right now of 10 and 20. And finally, this is the bit where I'm sending my response. So just as we did with the endpoints, a response.body.setValue, I'm passing in a JSON object to be decoded, and I'm saying true. That means that the endpoint code is going to take ownership of this object. We don't have to create it, that's already happened for us. And the final thing I need to do is now that we have our resource, I'm going to go ahead and set up an initialization section. And then here, what I need to do is register resource. Type info of my resource. So what that's going to do is that the initialization of the unit is going to go and look at see my resource. It's going to use all the runtime type information and this attribute to name it, and then it's going to publish that as one of the available service options for the component. Okay. So the next thing we need to do is to set our endpoint to active, or our endpoint to active. By doing so, the EMS server will be able to call it. So let's go ahead and grab a button, and we'll set this to activate. And one more time, I'm going to do some copy pasting here. I'm actually going to set two things to active. So the first thing I'm going to do is make sure that the edge service itself is active, and then I'm going to make sure that its listening service, so its server components, is also set to active true. Now before I've done this, I'm going to go back to my EMS management console, and I'm going to manually delete the one that I've already registered. The reason is, I'm going to have to register again, because when I registered for the first time, we didn't have our resource in there, and so as far as EMS is concerned, this endpoint doesn't have any resources. So rather than delete the unregistered code, I'm going to go ahead and use the console to delete that out. So go ahead and run this code again, and I'm going to show you the deliberate mistake, or actually here's a non-deliberate mistake, so I need to be including EMS resource APR. And that gives us types of CD endpoint context, CD endpoint question, so on. So okay, let's go ahead and run this. Okay, so what it looks. So I should still be able to do my handshake, but when I have to register, I should have a call. Okay, so what's going on here? Well, the code that's necessary to register the runtime type information is actually inside of EMS resource types. Now, the application will still build and run without this user's included, but as you've just seen, it will crash when you try to register the resource. Make sure you have this unit users and you won't get that error. So let's go ahead and try again. Okay, go ahead and register. And this time, it's successfully registered. So if I take a look back in the management console and do a refresh, we can see the EMS endpoint has been registered. Okay, so we have our thin point register. The next step is going to be to activate it. So click on activate, and our thin point is now enabled, so our EMS server can see it. And so we can go and access the data. I'm going to bring up the browser here. Let's see what happens to page buffer. Okay, so I've gone ahead and called our endpoint, our thin point, and I've got back X axis and Y axis. So let's take a look at the URL here. We're calling local host 88. That isn't the thin point itself, that's actually the EMS server. We're then asking for the EMS server's registered edge modules, and looking at our EMS thin point, and the requesting is joystick proxy. So what's happening is when we call for the registered edge module, it's going to go and find our EMS thin point and it's opening a connection to it. It then requests the joystick data and sends that back to us. So effectively the EMS server is proxying the thin point. The important part about that is you can have multiple thin points across your network. So if you have a factory floor with a number of Bluetooth tracking beacons, well, Bluetooth doesn't have a very long range. You can have multiple thin points within range of each of them. So this will give you the ability to collect the data and make that all available at a central location in your EMS server. Let's take a look now how we modify this thin point to collect the actual data from our joystick sensor. Okay, so we now have our thin point actually seen and working. So let's go ahead and modify this thin point to use actual data from the joystick. I have the joystick plugged here, and you've seen the code to build this TFA from the joystick before. I'm just going to run through it real quick one more time. So let's grab a COM4 component and put that on form. On this occasion, we'll make sure that that is set to COM4 3. Okay, and we'll have a unpackaged component, and that we're going to bind to COM4 shortly. Then we're going to have a generic real value, and in fact, we need two of those. So we've got two generic real values. And then in the code itself, actually, it's going to be wiring up first. So the COM port I'm going to feed into the unpackaged. The unpackaged needs to have some elements to decode the data that it's getting. So I'm going to go ahead and use two binary floats. And this is the binary float we're inputting from the joystick button as well. We're not using it in this application, but we need to make sure that it's in there. And I'm going to go ahead and bind up the float to the real. So they're bound. And then if we switch back to the designer, we come in and set the on-process data and for generic real to 1 float. And what I'm going to do here, I'm going to use a couple of just unicodal variables. So I'm going to have x axis is a real, and y axis is also a real. Now, obviously, you can put this data anywhere you like. I'm only going to be grabbing the most recent value from the joystick into these two variables. If you were reading data from a sensor, you could, of course, cache that data. And when the EMS server calls the thin point, the thin point can respond by sending all of the data up or all of the data sent to the max, to the edge, or what have you. We're just going to cache the latest value right here in x and y. So if I get my event handler, just say that x axis is the L value, the most recent L value from the controller. Let's take a copy of that, and then we're going to do the same thing again for the Y axis. So we have the X and Y values, and then down here in our get method, well, instead of passing given a JSON number, this time I'm going to change this to a put from X axis and the Y value value. And then I'm also going to pass in a put strut on the Y axis. Okay, so that's our module. Let's go ahead and build and run it. Okay, so I go ahead and activate, and that's activating my module. And now if I pull up our web browser here, and paste in our address, we can go off and take a look at the joystick reads. So there we have the joystick data coming back out, and I'm going to refresh this while moving the controller, and you can see that I'm offering the X and Y axis values. Okay, so now the endpoint is working. In the next part of tomorrow, we're going to take a look at how to document the endpoint that we've built in YAML. And we'll also look at how YAML is used to document the endpoint that we just built. YAML is a documentation format which we can then hand over to, say, a web developer or a .NET developer and have them access our services from their own .NET language. So we'll take a look at some examples of how we do that using JavaScript and C# tomorrow. Thanks for watching. My name is Craig Chapman.